back to the second part of my water tank plumbing system install. I just got my packages from Amazon. Let me show you what I ordered. I got a shurflo pump. Here's the specifications of everything. Runs on a 15 amp fuse if you want to put an inline fuse. 45 psi, 5 amps max, 12 volt system. Comes with a positive and negative cord. And I got this little filter for if there's anything inside of this tank, like debris or any type of foreign contaminants. It'll go through this, drop down in here, anything heavier than water. There was a mosquito in here. And it'll filter so the pump doesn't accumulate any debris. So it's going to come out of this and go into an accumulator tank. Accumulator. And what this does is you pump it up to your desired PSI. It's like a little, like a bike tire type of valve for pumping. And what this does is it keeps the pressure in your lines. So it goes into the pump. The pump pushes the water to a certain pressure, which this maintains that pressure, I guess is the best way to say it. So it goes into this pump, so the pump will not need to work as hard because it maintains the pressure through this accumulator. So up to 30 psi, anything below 30 psi, the pump will kick on, but anything below 30 psi, I think I said that right. Anything above 30 psi, the pump will kick on. Anything below the 30 psi, this will maintain that steady flow, that steady pounds per square inch through this. So all the water lines are going to be filled. There's not going to be any air pockets, any air bubbles. So when you turn on the water, it's not going to... It's going to come out steady because of this. Helps the pump not work as hard. Helps keep the lines working properly, and it'll last longer. And I didn't cover this in my last video, but I'm doing shark bite fittings, as you could tell. And the reason I'm doing that is I don't have that many fittings going through this, but the other options are crimp fittings, where you could do like crimp rings or crimp I forgot what they're called, but they're like the little rings with a little notch on the end, and you take a tool and you crimp it, and the tool clicks. It's like a little ratchet, and it clicks into place, and it tells you when the crimp is seated properly. And that tool was like $60 just for the tool, and then you buy a box of like 25 rings for like $50. Shark bite fittings are not cheap. It's like, I think this came with four L brackets, 90 degree brackets, half inch, and it was like $30. But I trust these a lot more than myself crimping each PEX pipe, each joint, I guess. And overall, I think the shark bites actually will end up being cheaper with how many connections I need to make. Like here's an example of something I did. So this is like a little bendy tube, and I just put it right on PEX pipe, and my other half inch that went to my ball valve, and I could just plug it right into this pump with a 90 degree fitting. And that eliminates about two or three of these 90 degree angles. And this thing was like 10 bucks, 12 bucks. And, you know, three less fittings that I need to worry about leaking. But there is another option for installing plumbing lines. It's called Pro PEX line, not regular PEX. and opener fittings, I think what it is, you get a like a tool that expands these little plastic collars that you slide on the end of your PEX pipe. It's like, there's your PEX pipe and you slide little plastic fittings. And what it does is it opens up and expands the Pro PEX, because I don't know if it works with regular PEX, but it expands it. And then you slide in your fittings and then it slowly compresses it. And then you could like slide it around and like that's the fitting. And those are pretty sturdy, pretty secure, don't leak. And there's a lot of good reviews about that stuff. But that whole system was beyond my financial capabilities. So I'm slowly buying and accumulating different types of adapters and different types of shark bite fittings, trying to figure out the best way to connect weird, awkward angles and making it all work together. There are, without needing to buy 90 degree angle brackets, they have, I don't have them in here, but they have little clamps that go on the outside of the PEX pipe, and what it does is it bends the PEX pipe in a 90 degree angle. It's just a wider, that's a pretty small area to bend 90 degrees, which is why those come in handy. But the other ones are more gradual 90 degrees, and it just takes up a lot more space. But I will be able to use those, and those are like $3 for a pack of two, I think it is. And those will come in handy, definitely. But there's countless ways of connecting different things, and just as long as everything's connected properly, you're pretty good. But the thought comes into how to connect it with using the minimum amount of connections, which is what I'm just having to think through and think it through. And then you could always take things back. I'm not ordering anything off of Amazon. I'm buying everything from Home Depot, so I can go up there, buy what I need, come back. If it doesn't work, I could take it right back, get a store credit, and then just try out different ways of doing it. So what I got so far is coming out of the water tank into my bendy connector. It's going into a filter, a particle filter. It's just like a little wire mesh thing on the inside of that. It's not like carbon drinking filter. It's just to catch some bigger particles than what that mesh is. And it it goes out of that into my pump. And both the pump and the accumulator say it doesn't matter which orientation they're in. You can mount it this way, this way, this way, this way. It doesn't matter. And it could be in and out on this one, but the pump does have arrows that show which direction. I don't think you could see it on the top of this. It's on the back. Which direction the water should flow. So a little figuring out, and I have figured out my connections for my pump. So accumulator runs directly across from the pump, from this half inch to half inch. The accumulator came with this connector for a connection like this. And on the little pamphlet that came with it, it said for winterization, it's best to mount it filler hole up. But since it's in the van, it doesn't matter about winterization. So you can mount this any which way. So it's fine doing it this way. And then I got this faucet connection, which goes from half inch. And what I liked about it is it has a valve. You can open and close it. So if you want to work on any of this, you can close it, or work on anything after, you can close this. And then it's running into a T connector. And the van floor has these three channels that are deeper than all the other channels. And what I found was I can run my half inch pipe through these channels, and then my floor, or my aluminum, will sit right on top of it, and the pipe can run right underneath it. Cross T connector is going into this one-way connector, where when the hot water is filling up this exchanger, it's not gonna back into this and it's not gonna go into my cold lines. So once it's past this, I don't have to worry about any heat coming anywhere else. And then at the bottom, I don't have it run yet, but I'm gonna come out, and with my 90 degree probably, I'm gonna run it in this channel, the deeper channel, and take it back to my shower, which is gonna be in the back corner. And cold lines are gonna run across the floor just like this, run across the floor in the back, and then go up, hot, cold, into my little mixer handle. See, guys, this is what I gotta deal with. This is why the van's not done. The van is not done because I have nuisances. See, look at that. She's trying to kill me.
Red rum.
Anyway, as I was saying, I don't know what I was saying.
Red rum.
Yeah.
Where's the knife? Red rum. Dorian, you were supposed to see the knife before you saw me.
Anyway. So as I was saying, I think it is a good time right now to put in my aluminum struts in the floor, because I have pretty much all the water components where they're supposed to go. Hey, how you doing? To attach this aluminum strut to the actual floor is I'm going to grind down the high spots that the aluminum strut touches, and that'll give me a solid point to attach the aluminum to, so I don't have to screw through the van floor, because I don't want to screw into the actual floor of the van. Before I glue it, what I'm going to do is cut all my struts and fit them where they're gonna need to go. I'm gonna approximate about 16 inches in between each strut, and then I'm gonna put my foam in between those, and that'll give me some insulation on the floor. And then I'm gonna cut my plywood to put on top of that, so that when I do glue the struts in place, it'll give me some weight to push down. And I could put some weights on top of the plywood as well, just to squish the aluminum into the floor with that glue. And that'll be a solid connection point. No screws necessary. Aluminum. Aluminium. It's very easy to cut. You can cut it using a regular wood saw. Just make sure to go really slow and always wear your safety glasses. So I stopped at my plywood box, and what I thought of was I'm gonna put a little brace in between this one and that one. So that's not 16 inches. But what I created is now an area I could seal and watertight, so that if I have any coolant leaks, I can just wipe it up. And I'm gonna put a piece of insulation like right here. But this is gonna be in a little cabinet where you're not gonna see anything, so I don't need to make this look pretty. And there, I don't think I'm gonna do that because I'm going to have to insulate that entire area because this is the only place I could put this joist without it messing up this pipe being on the floor. Okay, so I laid out all my struts all the way the length of the van. If it wasn't raining, I'd bring out my table saw, and I think the plan is tomorrow or whenever it stops raining that I'm going to cut insulation on my table saw at 16 inch strips so they're all perfect. And I could just lay them in, scoot the metal to the insulation, and just do that the entire way. That'll be tomorrow. Still raining outside. It's a new day. I'm still gonna, the ground is still soaked and the sky is still very gloomy looking. So I'm not gonna cut my insulation on my table saw today because any dust that is created is gonna get all wet and it's gonna be super difficult to clean up. So what I'm doing is I'm installing some of this Kilmat sound dampener onto my floors. And I'm leaving strategic places like the edges and a little bit and the top and the bottom. So when I put my insulation in, I can then run some glue on the floor to glue the insulation down. I probably won't need glue. It'll probably sit in there pretty well with the plywood on top of it. But this is just in case I do end up wanting to glue it. So I'm gonna put this on the entire floor. It's been about a week and a half, and it's still pouring rain outside. So what I did, I brought my saw to the basement, cleared a little space, and I'm gonna cut my insulation down here. It's not 100% necessary to cut your insulation on a table saw, but since I have one, it will definitely help making perfect strips for ease of installation later. So what I did is from the blade to the fence, I'm gonna cut strips of insulation at 15 and a quarter. And what that is going to allow me to do is my aluminum struts at 3/4 inch thick. It's gonna give me perfect 16 inch on centers for ease of drilling into my plywood, into my struts down the road. Just make things a little bit easier. I can measure it and know exactly where my studs lie. So let's make a mess. Made me some strips. I'm gonna see how far that's gonna get me. I have one more sheet left, but I might need some filler pieces, and those could be different variations in size. So I'm gonna see how far this goes, and I'll leave the rest for later. Well, there's my first piece of insulation. See how nice it makes that cut. I had to notch out that corner to fit in there, but pretty good. My blade is terribly rusty, so it left a jagged edge, but you score it and it snaps wherever you cut it, and that's pretty easy. And next I'm going to line up the next piece just like that, and I'm going to put in my rest of the insulation. Pretty straightforward, pretty simple. Get her done. Build in these crevasses, the deepest part with the bubble stuff, and I did that the entire length. Well, I'm going to. I did it over there underneath that hot line, so the cold of the van floor doesn't interfere with the heat of my hot line. It's gonna be going on underneath my subfloor. I'm gonna drill into my plywood, into my aluminum struts. And this insulation is 3/4 inch thick, and it says this is about a R somewhere on here. Let's see where it is. 3/4 R4. And if you know anything about our value, that's not very good. But with how tall I am, that is the maximum I could have gotten. I recommend, if you're anything below 6 foot, to put 1 inch insulation in. And that'll increase the R value a couple of digits. Clean. Put yourself down a piece of plywood so you don't dent it. This is about a half inch piece of plywood, 3/4 inch off the ground. And this is about where I stand. About 2.5 inches from hitting the ceiling. And that's without ceiling insulation or my actual ceiling or my actual floor. Here's what I did with my plumbing lines. Running through it, and I'm just cutting the insulation around it. I'm just running it right through the floor. That's where the joists run, and that's where the pipe runs in accordance to the plywood. And I still have a little bit of space, itty bitty, so it's not squishing my pipes at all. I just got back from my daily trip to Home Depot. It is an expensive time to be building a van. Very expensive. I don't know what in the world's going on with these wood prices. It was about $70 for 3/4 inch plywood per sheet, which is insane. So I got 1/2 inch, which was $40 a sheet. Typically, a couple years ago, it was like 28, something like that. It's gone up almost double the price. I even got one sheet. It was broken in half, and the broken in half on a couple layers. It was like peeled back, and I could glue it and fix it, and that was in the 70% off pile. So I saved on one sheet of plywood. So I got three others full price. I got a couple connectors for the shower. And it's not the regular subfloor, which has, I don't know what it's made out of, but it has big old knots in it. And whenever you get it at Home Depot, it's always doing like this. So it requires you to drill in every 2 inches to make it perfectly flat. So I went ahead and bought the nicer plywood, and it was actually cheaper than regular subfloor, which is crazy. But it's not as nice as birch plywood, which is what you use to finish furniture and stuff, but it's called Sandy Ply, S-A-N-D-E, Sand Ply, I don't know. Not the nicest, not the worst, but still very expensive. I spent like $200-something on just plywood and a couple connectors. This is what that 70% off piece of plywood looked like. I can rip that off and glue that. It'll be flush. This is how far I got. I had to stop right there for my plumbing lines. I'm gonna have to figure that out, and that'll probably be in the next video. But this is what the floor looks like. It got dirty again. It's real easy to get this thing dirty. But cutting the little pieces and fitting them in there, it's pretty tight all the way through. That's where I filled that gap, and over there under that, I filled that, leaving that little void for any coolant that might possibly leak out. I finished putting the kill mat sticky stuff underneath here. I know I didn't film the rest of that. Well, there's been a lot of running around and figuring out things, so I know my filming's kind of sporadic, and I know the starts of some of the videos. I don't know why that happens, where the start of some of the videos where I start talking, it cuts out the very first part, so it sounds like I'm jumping into it real quick. It's not my editing. It's something to do with my phone and the processing power. I don't know. So I'm having to start talking like 3 seconds into the video, and sometimes it still even cuts out me speaking. I don't know what that's all about. But I'm going to stop here. I'm going to have to figure out where my walls for my shower is going to go. And I'm going to figure out the 90 degree bend up of the hot line and the cold line going in this way. So I haven't put in my insulation there. That'll be the start of the next video. And I'll try to put in my plywood floors next video too. So next video is going to be all floors and a little bit of plumbing. So thanks for watching. Watch my next video. Comment if you have any questions. And see you later.